trying to get this big picture idea of what the Bible is and who God is and who God made us to be. So on a journey like that, in addition to reading through the Bible, there's other things I think that are helpful for us to do. And at least for me, I don't know about you, but at least for me, one of the things that I enjoy doing that helps me wrap my head around things is to know some stuff, just kind of some trivia, some different things about what I'm trying to figure out. So we're going to do a little Bible trivia quiz. Don't worry, it's not graded. You don't have to share it with your neighbor. You don't even have to write anything down. It's just up on the screen, and you can kind of think, which one do I think it is? So, first question. How many books in the Bible? Ah, you're bold. You're saying it. 66. Okay, you're right. Next one. How many chapters in the Bible? And you can probably guess, because it's not a round number. 1,189. Okay. How many verses are in the Bible? See, this helps us wrap our heads around these things. What do you think? I don't know, is it in the billions? Let's see, which one is it? 31,173. Okay, how about the longest verse in the Bible? Anybody know where the longest verse in the Bible is? Kind of strange. Let's see it. Esther 8:9. Never would have guessed that one, but there it is. And then how about the shortest verse in the Bible? There you go, John 11:35. And how about the middle chapter? If you took the Bible and you opened to exactly the middle, somewhere in Psalms, but the middle chapter is Psalm 117. And how about the middle verse? So if you found all the 31,000 or whatever it is verses and went to the middle, it would be Psalm 103. 1 and 2, because there's actually an even number of verses, so that's why. And then, in what century did verse numbers appear in the Bible? Because it didn't happen from the very beginning, but in what century did those verse numbers appear in the Bible? In 16th century. So it's been pretty recent. One other statistic that I think is interesting is, what is the story that is the longest story in the book of Genesis that takes up 25% or one quarter of the book of Genesis? I think you can guess. Joseph. Joseph takes up 13 chapters in a book that's only 50 chapters. I mean, that's more than creation. That's more than the flood. And Noah, that's more than Abraham and his whole adventure. I mean, that's more than any single event or any one person's life that's described in the book of Genesis. Or, for that matter, most of the Bible. And when I see that, just the sheer volume of how much space Joseph takes up, I mean, it makes me say, why? Why is that story so long? Because surely it could have been condensed. It could have told it in one chapter. But instead, you know, they strung it out. And it's a longer story. So why is it there? And I think it's there, in part, because it teaches us a couple huge mysteries and truths about who God is and who God made us to be. So we're going to look at that. Now, you know the story. You heard a little bit of it. But let's revisit the story, because there's a moment in the story that we need to get to. And the story, in short, is like this. Joseph was his father's beloved and favorite son. And Joseph, at one point, dreams some amazing dreams. And when he does dream these dreams about ruling over his brothers and about being in charge of them, his brothers are not happy, and they don't like it. So they deceive him, as Kim described, they deceive him, and they do mean things. They beat him up, they throw him in a well, and they sell him to Egyptians who are traveling by. To cover this up with their father, the sons lie and explain that Joseph was killed, and they have his colored coat to show for it that's blood-stained, and they give it to Jacob. Of course, his father, Jacob, is distraught because he lost his son, and Joseph, meanwhile, heads to Egypt, and he's eventually imprisoned. Well, Pharaoh has these dreams, and Pharaoh doesn't find anybody to interpret and help understand these dreams, so he calls up Joseph out of prison, and Joseph comes and interprets these dreams. Joseph makes clear that it's God is the one who's giving him wisdom to interpret these dreams, and eventually he does. And he gives this truth to Pharaoh, and Pharaoh is appreciative, and Pharaoh honors him, and so he puts Joseph in a place of success. Well, meanwhile, back in Canaan, the family was not too happy. There's a severe famine. That's flood and hunger that we learned about. And it's so severe that they run out of food. They run out of food and they need to go find somewhere else. And it seems that all the world, the known world, is coming to Egypt to get food because Egypt has a surplus of this food. So who is there to administer all of this food distribution but Joseph? And Joseph's brothers all come to Egypt trying to get food. Of course, they don't know it's Joseph, as we just heard with the kids, but they get their food. They go back home. This happens a couple times. And eventually, Joseph realizes, I need to do something here. So he hides something in their sack of food and that belongs to him, belongs to Pharaoh, and then he accuses them of stealing it so that they will come back to Egypt. And the brothers are just... they're worried about their lives, they're freaked out because they're being called back and they're being asked about something they don't know anything about. I mean, they are worried, and then Joseph is there and they don't know it's Joseph, and we're reading the story thinking, what's going to happen? You know, is Joseph going to reveal that he's their brother? Are the brothers going to get imprisoned? Are they ever all going to see their father again? How does it all happen? And it's at that moment in the story that something just clicks for Joseph. Now, I wonder if you would be so bold as to do something. And that is to get up and find another seat in the room. So please get up. You can find a seat anywhere you'd like, but it cannot be next to where you were. It needs to be somewhere else in the room. It can be far away, it can be on the other side, it can be up front, it can be back behind, it can be anywhere you want it to be. If you need a blue chair where you are, you can ask somebody to move your chair. It can be wherever you want it to be. You go, find your spot. Okay, when you find your spot, settle in, because this is where you are for the rest of our time together. I hope you like who you're sitting next to. Okay, now, take a look. Take a look around where you are. What do you see that's different? Just think about it. What do you see? And now tell somebody near you or next to you or somewhere, tell them one thing that you see that's just different. Okay? Just one thing, real quick. It's an article called The Work of Leadership, and he's kind of an expert on situations of change in life. And his whole perspective on dealing with change is that we have to see whatever situation we're in from a different perspective in order to deal with our change. Because so much of the time, he says, and I think he's right on, we just live in the things we're doing. You know, we live in the work we're doing, we live in the school classroom that we're in, we live on the sports team that we're on, we live in our chores and our routines, we live on the road that we travel. I mean, we just, and that's part of life. You know, we have to do the stuff that we do. But so often we just live in that. That's where we focus our time, that's where we give our attention, and we rarely ever look at things outside of those places and perspectives. So his whole idea is that in order to address any situation of change in our lives, we need to, what he calls, get on the balcony. And for him, that's very figurative, but it's also a very literal thing. We need to get on the balcony and to be able to see life from a different perspective so that we can see how our part or our activity or our thing fits into everything else. Because, you know, when you're on the road, you can't see all the roads. When you're in an office, you can't see the whole space. When you're in the classroom, you don't see everything. I mean, we got to see the whole space. William and Madeline just started soccer practice this past week for the spring season. And I see this so clearly on the soccer field. That most of the time, soccer is about trying to kick the ball, trying not to trip, trying to keep the ball in bounds, trying to maybe pass to one other person, trying to make sure you're going the right direction. I mean, it's all about the field stuff. And those of us on the sidelines, or if you're watching it on TV, we think, oh wait, you could do that. Or, oh, there's a clear path right to the goal, go right through there. Or no, make this play, because you could go there. Because we see it from a different perspective. And we can see something different because of where we are. And this was Joseph's moment. There was this moment where all of a sudden, he got on the balcony. Or he got a new chair. Or he saw his life from a different place. And that's when everything clicked about how it all fit. So here's the moment where it clicks. It's Genesis chapter 45, right in the middle of the story. It's in your bulletin. It's up on the screen. Can't miss it. Joseph couldn't control himself anymore in front of all of his attendants. And this is when his brothers all come to get food and are called back. So they're all together. He cried out, "Have everyone leave me." So there wasn't anyone with Joseph when he told his brothers who he was. He wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard him. Everyone in Pharaoh's house heard about it. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" But his brothers weren't able to answer him. They were too afraid of him. Joseph said to his brothers, "Come close to me." So they did. Then he said, "I am your brother Joseph. I am the one you sold into Egypt. But don't be upset and don't be angry with yourselves because you sold me here. God sent me ahead of you to save many lives. For 2 years now, there hasn't been enough food in the land, and for the next 5 years, people won't be plowing or gathering crops. But God sent me ahead of you to keep some of you alive on earth. He sent me here to save your lives by an act of mighty power. So then it wasn't you who sent me here, it was God. He made me like a father to Pharaoh. He made me master in Pharaoh's entire house. God made me ruler of the whole land of Egypt." Then Joseph threw his arms around his brother Benjamin and wept. Benjamin also hugged him and wept. Joseph kissed all his brothers and wept over them. After that, his brothers talked with him. This is the moment when Joseph finally realizes how all this fits together. Because before this, there's a few moments in the story of Joseph where we see that he doesn't understand. He is confused and he's frustrated and he doesn't get it. But this is the moment when it clicks. And he finally is up there being able to see, so my suffering was worth it. Oh, so that's why my brother sold me into Egypt. Oh, so that's why they deceived me. So that's why I'm successful in Egypt. I mean, it all just finally, in that moment, clicked. And I think what Joseph realized is that God has always been working. God has always been working. Sometimes it was behind the scenes. Sometimes it didn't make sense. Sometimes it was the opposite of what he thought God should be doing. But God was working the whole time. He realized God is always working in his life. I have to wonder, well, what's God doing? Because, you know, it's frustrating sometimes when we don't see God working in the ways we want. So what was God doing that whole time? What was God making happen during that time? Well, I think it's fair to say that God was working to make things new. Because Joseph needed them to be new, and it didn't make sense what was happening, so God had to make something brand new happen. This is why I think God is often like the manager of a donation center at like Emergency Aid or the Rescue Mission or Goodwill or Salvation Army. And you've made donations somewhere before. You've dropped them off. Yes, at a donation center. Yes? And when you drop them off, you know, you drop off boxes and bags and individual things that don't fit in bags, and you just drop them off. Now, for the most part, what does the donation center tend to look like? A warehouse. A garage. A mess. I mean, not that it's not a mess, but it's kind of like a mess. There's stuff. You know, there's lamps over here, and there's furniture over here, and there's girls' clothes here, and there's boys' clothes here, and up on the shelf there's stuff, and there's piles of bags and piles of boxes. I mean, there's just stuff everywhere. And I feel like God is this manager of all our stuff that we drop off with God. And some of it's in good condition, some of it's not. You know, some of it's really hopeful, some of it's faithful, other of it's just a mess. There's a lot of dirty stuff. And we just drop it all off with God. And God somehow does something with it. And I think most of the time, God makes new things out of it. Because that's what God can do. God takes our stuff, no matter what it is, no matter what our situation or our events or who we've become, and God just makes us new. That's how God works. That's the way that God operates. Now, there's a place in the book of Philippians that I think affirms this and describes it in a slightly different way, but I think it's helpful. It says, "Work hard to show the results of your salvation, obeying God with deep reverence and fear. For God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases him." God makes things new. God works within us to make that happen. And how does God do that? How does God make stuff happen and make new things in us? I don't know either. I don't know the formula. I don't know the recipe. I don't know the strategy. I don't know. But I'm willing to guess that we've all had those moments where all of a sudden, like Joseph, it just clicks. You know what I mean? And it's that moment when we say something like, you know, "Oh, now I get it. I didn't get it before, but oh, now I get it. That makes sense." And every one of us, I think, has an now I get it kind of story. And that's a great story to tell. One of the things, because this is our last moment in the book of Genesis, and as we leave Genesis, I don't want to leave it without making sure we get something about Genesis that I think is so important. Because it's a different kind of book than a lot of the other books in the Bible. I mean, if you compare Genesis with, like, Philippians that we just read from, or some of the letters of Paul, or the book of Numbers, or some others, I mean, it's radically different. There's no data. There are no numbers. There's no spreadsheets, you know, there's no metric to Genesis, and there's no explanation of a lot of stuff that happens. It's just story. I mean, it's story after story after story after story. There's a German theologian who's still alive. He's writing and teaching today. He's a brilliant guy, and we'll just call him Walter, because he's got a last name that I probably can't pronounce very well. And he wrote an amazing thing about the book of Genesis overall. It's a little long, but I think we can get through it. He says this, "The narrative, or the story of Joseph specifically, he's writing about, the story of Joseph affirms that God's purpose is hidden and mysterious. It's hidden so that no participant in the story has a clue about it until now." And now he's talking about this moment in Joseph's life. "The purpose does not depend on human resolve or willingness. There is no hint about how it happens. At the crucial turns, the narrative moves abruptly and tersely, refusing to reflect or cause on method. That's why story is the proper mode for this faith. It never lingers to explain, but only recites and retells for the wonder found in the telling. Biblical faith affirms and moves on, even when we would pause to analyze and explain. It will linger to relish and discern the wonder, but never to explain." And somehow we're supposed to be okay with that. Because I feel like I want to be Paul a lot of the time. I want to explain it. I want to describe it. I want to show exactly what it means. I want to parse it. I want to just dissect it. And this says, no. Because that's not what Genesis is all about. It's about the story. and about what God is revealing in that story. Here's another way, maybe, of talking about it. We rarely understand how God acts. We can't always explain it. We might notice sometimes when God acts, but we've got to share just the fact that God acts. Because sometimes it doesn't always make sense. Sometimes we might notice it or not. All we can do is share the story. The story that God acts. And your story, that is the most important story, is one of those stories that's the, oh, now I get what God's doing story. You know, it might have happened 100 times, it might have happened only once. But when it clicks, and when we realize, oh, that's what God did, that's your story. And that's your story that other people need to hear, especially people who don't know this God of Genesis that we've looked at. Because when we tell that story, it's worth the telling. So here's your project, and my project. Here's our project. Pick a story from your life, and oh, now I get a kind of story, and tell. Because if it's a real story about you, and what you've discovered about God, and what I've discovered about God, it's real. And you're going to tell it well, because it's your story. So pick that story, and tell it to someone. Can we do it? Maybe. When you do it, share what happens with somebody else, because we all need to know. We all need to know what we did and how it worked and what God did, and maybe there's even another story that we get to share from that. God gives us stories so we can tell those stories over and over. Would you pray with me?